A vacuum chuck is a perfect solution for holding large, thin workpieces that just can't be held in a vise. More surface area means more holding power, so what about smaller parts that aren't held as well? Well, in this video, I'm going to show you exactly how to do just that. Let's get started. So let me start off by showing you the two parts that need to be machined. These are left and right component, pretty close in size and shape. In fact, they're the same outside profile, just the inside features are different. They measure roughly 2.75 by 1.5 inches. This is important to know because in all vacuum work holding, surface area is key. Let me pull up my calculator to get some rough numbers to see what kind of holding forces we can expect. 1.5 times 2.75 gives us a surface area of 4.125, and we're going to multiply that by 14, which is the holding power in pounds per square inch. That gives us, we'll call it 57 pounds. Now imagine a column of air sitting on top of the part, extending to outer space. That column would weigh 57.75 pounds. The way that vacuum works is the weight of the column of air is actually trying to fill in the vacuum, but the part is in the way. That's how parts are held. That's why surface area is so important. So let me show you the finished design that I came up with, and we'll work backwards. This is a 13.5 inch top plate, which bolts on top of our equally sized chuck. Now, a few features I put in here. I put in set screws on this backside, and there's four flanged screws to help hold the remnant material. We'll get into that in a second. Now, our customer had to make 500 of each one of these parts, so creating a custom top plate is definitely the way to go. Each cycle, we're going to have 12 of the windowless part and another 12 of the windowed part. So let me show you a zoom in of the windowless part. Now, I created a gasket groove that sits just inside the perimeter of the part. I went with 1/16 inch diameter gasket on this one because we're trying to maximize the surface area within the gasket pattern. We typically recommend 1/8 inch, but 1/16 inch just gets us that little extra area, which is key in vacuum work holding. So this has an area of 3.52 square inches. 3.52 times 14. This part will be held with 49 pounds of holding force. This area over here has a surface area of almost exactly 2.5 inches. And again, multiplying that by 14, this part will be held with 35 pounds. So that's good, but it's not great. Cutting forces can greatly exceed that. You're not gonna get any lifting from an end mill as much as you're gonna get side loads, which slide the part off of the gasket pattern, breaking the seal, and then you lose your part. That's why nesting all these parts together is a little trick to maximize the holding power, because when we're machining one part, we get the benefit of the surrounding part's surface area to hold that in place. Let's take a look at the cam side of it. So here's what it's going to look like when all 24 parts are finished on the chuck. Let me walk through some of the tool paths to show you every tip and trick. So in yellow here is the stock. And these parts nested really well in a 12 inch square piece of material. Now, ideally, the parts would nest with very little scrap on the outside edges. The way that the math worked out, we had a little extra material shown here along the edges, which if we had more, I would have created a gasket pattern to hold the remnant piece. But we're right on the edge there. I opted to go with these flanged head screws just to hold the material down and also to give it a work stop. So this first tool path is interesting. The basic strategy is to ramp down to nearly full depth, but we're gonna leave about 20 thousandths of material at the bottom of the cut so that when we rough machine these parts, they're still interconnected until we take our final finish pass at full depth. So you can see this red line ramps down and it profiles it. Now you notice I'm only doing these four corner pieces. Let me show you why. When I simulate this part right here, the cutter here is surrounded by a part above it and below it, which essentially gives it 360 degrees of support. As we step through, when we get to this point right here, now there's material supported by the vacuum to the left and right of the cutter, but not in front of it, only behind it. Here's where parts can become an issue when you approach the outside corner of your workpiece. So we've machined along this edge, no problems, but when we get here, the cutting forces are only held by this back section of material here. There's no material in this quadrant, or this quadrant. So we only have 25% support for this cut. When you're cutting along a side, you have 50% support. And the best one is when you're on an inside corner with adjacent parts, you have 100% support around the cutter. In this tool path, I use 6,000 RPMs and a feed rate of 25 inches a minute with an 1/8-inch cutter. That's really conservative, but I value process reliability when working with multiple parts. You don't want to scrap an entire sheet. In this next tool path, we're taking the same cut, again, each of the parts except for the corner ones, again leaving 20/1000ths of the material at the bottom. And this feed rate I went with 80 inches a minute, no problem since most of these parts are fully supported. In this tool path, we're working with the holes that are drilled through. Now in vacuum applications, you don't want to drill through if that through feature is inside your gasket pattern. Once you break through, loss of vacuum, parts not held. So instead of using a drill, I'm just interpolating each one of these as if they were bores and leaving about 10/1000ths of material at the bottom, because then they can easily be chamfered out by hand when we're done with the parts. And this tool path takes care of the holes for the inside parts. And I've patterned them so that we don't have to keep picking the same redundant geometry. This next tool path pockets out the window at full depth. And I also added a finishing pass radially just to make this dimension nice and tight. And finally, we are going to duplicate all the tool paths of the roughing, but again, we're just gonna machine it at full Z depth. In fact, we're going 10/1000ths below the part just so we know we have a clean break. So we finish at full depth so that that light cut is last, because once you break these parts out individually, they're on their own. They're not being supported by the surface area of their neighbors, so the lightest cut should always be taken last. Let's go out to the shop and cut these parts and see how they turn out.
So the trick to holding smaller work pieces is all about maximizing surface area by using smaller diameter gasket and using neighboring parts for added stability. Keep that in mind, and thanks for watching.